Bible says how I can raise up ordinary men, turning them to become supernatural beings, financial bosses, making life better, bringing people from the dungeon of sin, bringing them into the faith, planting their feet, and rising them.
Holy Ghost! Holy Ghost!
Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5 to 6. He said, "And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise not the chastising of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him." In verse 6, "For whom the Lord loveth, he chastised and scourged it, every son whom he receiveth." For whom the Lord loveth, he chastised. Not only chastised, he scourgeth. The son that he loved, he rebuked. And after rebuking that son, he beats them with cane. And after that, he received him. Am I communicating? Let's read 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15. "But as he which hath called you is holy, so ye be holy in all manner of conversation." Hebrews 13, verse 17. I'm just giving you anchor scriptures so that we can move with those scriptures. Hebrews 13, verse 17. "Obey them that have rule over you, and submit yourself, for they watch over your souls, and they that must give account, that they may do that with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you." Hallelujah. We want to move forward today, and I want to talk to us on understanding discipline and discipleship. Understanding discipline and discipleship. I taught you we give Jesus some clamp offering. Disciples are not made overnight. And there could be no discipleship without discipline. There can be no disciples without discipline. And sometimes, if the teachings about spiritual discipline is not given to the body of Christ in full dosage, it doesn't matter how we claim to be spiritual, we become charlatans in the body of Christ. I said, there cannot be any disciple without discipline. When we talk about discipleship, we talk about discipline. If you have ever been to the Nigerian army to be trained to become a soldier, you will understand what it means to be a disciplined person. It is only in the body of Christ I've seen that people want to do things anyhow. And they don't want to be called to order. They don't want to be rebuked. They don't want to be chastised. They don't want correction. And they want things to be done anyhow. For example, if you are looking for a job and you get to an company or an organization or anywhere you go to, you find out that you get there, you meet the security, from the security, you meet the secretary, from the secretary, or what, the reception, and they ask you to wait. Do you argue with them? You don't argue. If you have ever gone to American embassy or any embassy at all, do you go with your handset? No, do you go with your handset? They ask you to switch off and drop your handset with an ordinary security man, and you obey. Why do you obey? Because you are looking for something, isn't it? And not only that, but you know that that is a system that has been put in place by that organization. You don't ask questions, why should I off my handset? You just know it's a system. Am I communicating? Okay, you are a civil servant or you are a place of work. There is a system that has been put in place. You have to resume your work at about 7:30 or 8. And there is a time book. You come in, you fill your time book and sign. And when you are going out, you sign off that you have closed and you put the time that you are going out. Am I communicating? And you obey that. Why do you obey that? Because it has been, it is a structure that have been placed in, that have been put in place that you have to obey. And if you don't obey it, you are not fit to be in the system. Can I talk here? Am I communicating? If you don't obey it, you are not fit to be in the system. When you go to mere eatery centers, you find securities. When you want to park your car, do you just park your car anywhere? They park you at the space that is available and you properly park. Why? Because there is a system. It is only in the body of Christ. We don't respect structure. We don't respect system. And we want to become children of the Most High God. Our God is too disciplined to father indisciplined children. Our God is too disciplined, too organized. Do you see how he placed the star? Do you see how he placed the moon? Do you see how he make one to be there by day and one to be there by night? He is an organized God. And if this God is so organized, he cannot be the architect of confusion. If people of the world know how to organize their system, why should we misbehave in the church? Tell your neighbor, spiritual discipline. Say it again. Said neighbor, spiritual discipline. Can you appear before the president of your country and be receiving call? No. You can do that. But how do you appear before the Most High God and go to receive call outside in the service? You are not disciplined. It doesn't matter whether you are a leader, a pastor, a deacon, or anyone. It doesn't matter. Discipline starts when I see the way some of you behave, and I go to so many churches and I see how believers behave. I can tell the gross level of irresponsibility. If we all know God, he said, a servant fears his master. He said, a servant fears his master. If I am your father, where is my fear? Where is my honor? In Malachi, if you honor me, is this how to honor me? How do I receive call in the presence of my pastor? People are coming for counseling and you're on your phone and you want to receive call and you know others are waiting. But you can't do that before an unbelieving political leader. We don't know, our honor system have died. We have, the way we even handle men of God, it is so very, very bad. How much more God?
I can tell you that when you cannot discipline yourself to honor God, you are not worth to be called a disciple. How can a man of God be preaching and you walk out? No discipline, no honor for the word. If there is an honor for God and for the word, you will not do that. Some of you come on Sunday, that's where you come at home meeting to discuss. You will not wait after the service. You will not wait before the service. You make unnecessary mini meeting because your honor system have died. As soon as you get into this environment on Sunday, whether the man of God is there or not there, there is a God watching your activity. Watching the way you honor him. Watching the way you behave. Those days, I grew up in the Anglican setup. I remember when we come to the church, how we've been taught. We fold our hands and keep quiet. Because we feel that God is watching whatever we do. The whole place is so quiet and calm. Then you hear the sound and of the organist just playing quietly in a serene environment. And everybody, you cannot even hear a pin moving. Why? Because the Lord is present and the whole earth is calm. But I have seen the level of gross misconduct and misbehavior around the Pentecostal cycle. The way we honor God is so bad because we are not disciplining ourselves. If I can go to an embassy and switch off my phone before I go in to submit my application, why should I keep my phone on in the service when the presence of God is busy moving? I don't need the security to tell me. My conscience should tell me. Everywhere is quiet. Discipline means any training intended to develop moral character or produce a pattern of positive behavior. Discipline means any training intended to develop moral character, moral character, moral character, or to produce a pattern of positive behavior. To produce a pattern of positive behavior. Any training, any spiritual drilling that is intended to produce moral character, godly virtue with a pattern to produce positive behavior. So anything that God that comes my way in the church that is intended to produce a positive character in me, to inculcate, insert in me a godly behavior, then it's a spiritual discipline. I have seen people leave church because pastor corrects them. You are not matured, you are a baby. I have seen people talk recklessly. You talk recklessly, and the way you talk, when somebody look at you, you know you are not born again. Those days, when we fight in the school, our teacher will ask us to kneel down and they will deal with us. Hello? They will deal with us. And in fact, the whole class will not even room at us and say, woo. It will become a shame. Next time, even when we're coming to school the next day, you'll be ashamed of what has happened. Is it not pathetic that sometimes people leave home to come and fight in the church? You are watching me on air. Don't pretend. I'm talking to the whole body of Christ, not this champion. People leave house to come and fight in the church because they feel that there is no orderliness, that in the church they can misbehave, that nobody will arrest them, nobody will call them to order. That's the level of mentality that have been inserted into our level, that we can misbehave in the church and go away with it, that nobody can question us. And no, I beg to disagree, that you cannot just come to the church and misbehave. The church should become a nucleus and a body and entity that should uphold discipline. Discipline. One of the best schools that have ever produced good children with moral standard are missionary schools. And that's why I can tell you that it is only in the body of Christ that discipline can be produced. And if you as a believer cannot live a life that is worthy of discipline, that you cannot even bring yourself down to a proper self-control, then you are not mature to be called a believer. We don't talk about spiritual maturity without spiritual discipline, because it is discipline that is the gateway to spiritual maturity. And I must say this, that until you get to a level where you call yourself to order and say, if Jesus was to be here, will he do these things and say this thing and act this way? If he will not do it, I will not do it.
Someone says spiritual discipline. I didn't hear you well. Say it well.
I have to talk about the discipline part, because without saying that, we can't even talk about maturity. We can't even talk about discipleship.
Discipline is a training that corrects, mold, or perfect the mental faculty or moral character of a person. Discipline is a training that corrects, mold, build, or perfect the mental faculty or the moral character of a person. So each time discipline is instilled in a place, we find out that people's pattern of thinking is shaped.
Haven't you seen people say, why should we follow this pattern? Is it not church? Everybody should just come in at any time. Everybody, when you hear people say they should do it anyhow, you find out that the spirit of lawlessness and lack of structure and hierarchy is not in that person. And I can tell you, any church without a structure cannot stand the test of time. That the fact that we are born again, we are not born again to be mumus. We are born again to display an high level of divine wisdom. The day you got born again, there was a dramatic display in the upgrading of your mind. Your mindset, your mentality had been upgraded to think wisely and to act sensibly. So you must understand, as children of God, we are not desiring the sincere meek. It is time to chew bone. And the child that the father loved, he chastised. I'm telling you that any point in time where you get with your pastor and he corrects you and you get offended and you feel like leaving the church, you don't love that pastor, he's not even your shepherd, and you are not ready to be a disciple, because there can be no discipleship without discipline. Jesus one day, as a matter of fact, told Peter, he said, the devil desire to have you, but nevertheless, I prayed for you. And after some time, Peter began to speak, and the certain words that Peter spoke to Jesus, Jesus knew that this was not the kind of word that should come out of the mouth of a believer. Jesus, looking at Peter, looked at the devil inside Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan. All the other disciples heard him saying to Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. That's an highest level to rebuke a man. But Peter did not took offense, because Peter understood whatever the master said, he is correct in his acute and judgment. I know it was towards my soul.
work with leader that will never tell them they are wrong. And the day he tells them they are wrong, they are offended. How can you say you love a leader? He's ministering, you don't have the writing material to write. What kind of honor system do you have? Your honor system is bad, it doesn't matter. You don't have a computer brain. He also wrote. He wrote his message down to prepare for you. And you claim to love him. You can't write down the message. You are a gross level of indiscipline, son. It doesn't matter what you think. Because your honor system for the message is not there. An outsider should not come to teach you what you should do. If you cannot honor him by writing down his message, wow, how will somebody honor you when you talk? I'm talking about a level of discipline. A level where you get to when you treat your leader with discipline. When you treat your leader and make them know, I am not just following you as a high service follower. I am a disciple. I have disciplined myself to follow you. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. If he's your shepherd, he will shape in and sharpen your life. He will shape your life. He said, he lead me. He lead me. Your shepherd is to lead you in the path of righteousness. So he drags you even when you don't want to go. He leads you. He drags you in the path of righteousness. And that's why I can tell you that if you are not disciplined to follow, you are not still a disciple. There is difference between a member and a disciple. A member comes in to appear and appear and to bear the name and present. But a disciple is part of the building block. Jesus had 5,000 members who came to eat the five fish and the loaf of bread. But out of those 5,000 members, there were 12 that were his disciples. The body of Christ and Christianity was not built on members, it was built on disciples. And that's why I can tell you, I'm not here to raise members, I'm here to raise disciples. It doesn't matter how many. I want to tell you that the disciples are not after the carrot, they are not after the cucumber, they are not after the gift, they are not after the miracle, they are after the message, because they want to take the message to the world. And that's why I ask you, are you a disciple? And if you want to be a disciple, you must submit yourself to discipline.
Sit down.
Now hear this. When you are disciplined, you know the message, you obey the message, you force yourself to obey it. How do you be a worker? You are not a tither. And you don't see anything wrong in being not being a tither. And you say you love the league, you love the system. You don't love the system. You're an hypocrite. Others can come in and benefit from the teachings of your pastor. And you that is in the system, you are not practicing it. And you are busy saying, I'm here. You are not here. You are absent. You can be president and you are absent. You can be in the church for 8 years and your presence means absent. Because you are not around the pillars of principles that makes up the ministry to work. No magic makes a man great. Adherence to spiritual principles. Adherence. Where there is discipleship, there is discipline. And where there is discipline, familiarity dies. Hello? I said, where there is discipline, what? Familiarity dies. My mother so much disciplined me to a point whereby she taught me not to collect things from people anyhow. When I was very small, a friend came to visit her and she bought some things. She was eating those things, and I sat down looking at the friend. And she did like this for me. Then my body language was going to collect it. Then my mother did like this. I did not understand. She did like this. I did not understand.
Then the friend look at my mother laugh. Then she look at me again and did like this. I did not understand. Then when I saw the friend look at my mother again, my mother said, So I collected it. I was eating in the presence of my mother. I never know that. My mother was laughing. I said, hey. So she told me, hey, go inside. Go and stay inside. Me too. I was happy. I went inside. I was eating the thing, enjoying my life. So the woman just left. My mother followed me with slippers. Pa, 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 pa. Say, you this time. Didn't you see my eye? I said, I did not see your eye. He said, shut up. Pa, pa. And every word she said, she was releasing cane on my head. Why? The one that was in my mouth, I vomited it. Then the next time, one of my father friend came. He was also eating again. And he now said, hey, come and eat. When he said, come and eat, I look at my mother. And she did me like this. I said, I recognize her. I remember the beating that she gave me before. I said, me? I will eat this food. No way. He said, can you come and say, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Even when I want to eat it, I say, thank you, sir. I ran outside the house, bruh. I'm talking about discipline. Look, it is only disciplined children that when your father corrects you the first time, you don't allow it to repeat. The Bible said, affliction shall not rise the second time in the land of the living. I prophesy, you will not fail again. I say you will not fail again. Shout that amen like thunder.
There are two types of discipline, and I call it personal discipline, and the other one, which has to do with self-discipline, and the other one is divine discipline. Two types of discipline. Number one, personal discipline. Self-discipline is personal training that develops self-control, character, resulting in an orderly an efficient life. Personal discipline is a training that develops self-control, character, resulting in an orderly and efficient life. You must practice self-discipline in the power of the Holy Spirit. Why self-discipline is necessary, you must understand. To produce that holy nature, godly nature, that godly character in us. And now, look at it. What we can expect when we fail to practice self-control, or when we are indisciplined, when we don't practice self-control. Number one, we become defensive about our sinful lifestyle. When you don't have self-control, you give reasons why you live the opposite way of life. Have you heard people say, that one did that sin now, why will I not do it? Because such kind of person cannot live a life of self-control. Number two, what we can expect when we fail to practice self-control. It affects our health. What do I mean by self-control? Self-control on what to eat. What to eat. God will not come down to plan to stop you from eating. If you want to eat like Yokozuma, you will eat like Yokozuma. Then you will have weight and occupy space. I saw one man over the internet, they were trying to carry him. About 10 men, trying to carry him. He cannot even lift up himself again from the bed. He cannot lift up himself again from the bed. That thing didn't start overnight. It started by the way he could not control the way he eats. Self-discipline. Holy Ghost will not come down to help you do that. Yes,
There are kind of food you can eat overnight. In the next 1 year, you get your pot belly. So very big, it's normal. You can't be taking akpu every night and there is no way for digestion. The Holy Ghost will not come down to help you plan it. Your stomach will shoot out and become like any kind of thing there. God will not come down to help you plan your the way you look like. Your husband is complaining that you are fat. Self-discipline. Control the way you eat. Apart from controlling the way you eat, do exercise. And he said, no, no, it doesn't matter. It matters. I say it matters. It matters. There are women like you who would have been more fatter than you. They control it by the way they do self-discipline. If you cannot even control what goes into your mouth, how can you control your own spiritual destiny? You are eating, 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 eating. Everything you see, you eat. Meat pie, honey pie, burger pie, fish pie, pig pie, goat pie, cow pie, crocodile pie. Can I teach here? Self-control. 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 You must have self-control over yourself. If not, you will fall sick unnecessarily. Why are everybody looking at me?
They're keeping quiet.
You cannot say because you're an Igbo man, you want to make money, make money. You are drinking garri now for the past 7 months. Your blood level has gone down. You will soon die. Can I teach here? Holy Ghost cannot become blood tonic. You need to balance that diet. Balance that diet. You need to work on yourself if you want to live long.
Saying now we need to save, we need to save, we need to save. Don't save for another person to eat. Somebody shout fire. It can harm our finances and get us into debt. That's what we can expect when we fail to practice self-control. Can harm our finance and get us into debt. You just, there are people once they owe 1 million, the money has gone. No self-control. They are owing debt everywhere. Everywhere. Buy things they are not supposed to buy. You must get an ability where you have money in your bank and the money is not controlling you. You are controlling the money. I can tell the body language of some people when they have money. Their body is shaking. They are busy entering motor. I need to go to Hussein. I need to go to there. They are, why? They cannot see money in their account. Their body will be shaking. Drive everywhere. Go to all the eatery center. Eat everything that they want to eat. Because they have gotten 2 million naira. Until that 2 million naira finish, then they become quiet. So Lord, my God, how excellent is your name.
Why? Because the money has left their pocket.
Somebody shout fire. What can we expect when we fail to practice self-control?
We perform poorly in our job. How can you be in your place of assignment and because you don't have self-control, you stroll up and down as if you eat dog leg? You are walking over. Where are you going to? You walk from here to there. You are going. Your boss said, where are you going? He said, I just want to reach. You are in the place of work. You perform poorly in the place of work because there's no self-control. The ability to tell yourself that I have a wife at home to feed. I have children to take care of. I cannot play with my job. I must discipline myself to perform in this organization because I want promotion. I'm telling you this. As your pastor, I prepare myself. Because I cannot come here. I know you are a bunch of intelligent people. And I cannot come here and just come and just stand. And I say, Eze, go to school every day. You will love me. When you perform poorly in your job, you have failed to have what I call self-control over yourself. No man can give what he does not have. Control yourself. Control yourself.
Oh. Self-control. Someone say self-control. I did not hear you well. What can you expect when you fail to practice, when you fail to have self-control? You develop a slothful habit, a lazy habit. A lazy habit. You arrive late. You arrive late to work, arrive late to church. And when you are coming, you are doing like people who are marching for wedding. It doesn't matter to you. What can you expect? When you don't have self-control, any man can stop you and control your life. How can you be planning to go to Use? Somebody stopped you and took you to Kaduna. Are you a normal human being? You are not normal. Something is wrong. Because you saw a car. Isn't it? What is bad? What is wrong in car? What's the big deal about about entering a car? They now put on the AC. Because you are now in AC, you forgot that you are going to Use. You are now, you find yourself in Kaduna. May God help you that they don't take you to Boko Haram zone. Don't mind me. Somebody shout fire. I prophesy to you. I see a new beginning. I see a new beginning. What is required for a disciplined life? Number one, have a definite purpose. Have a purpose for life. A purpose for life. What is required for a disciplined life? Don't just be aimless in life. There must be a purpose, a goal that you must set. Number two, disassociate from anything that can distract your pursuit in life. Disassociate from it. How do you live? What is required? I'm talking about what is required for a disciplined life. A disciplined life. Disassociate from anything that can distract you from your pursuit in life, your goal in life. Whether it's your friend, if they are not going your direction, disassociate from them. You have a life to live. Somebody must not force himself to be your friend. You choose your friend, they don't choose you. If you are not good around me, leave me alone. I want to enjoy my life. You are not called to destroy me. If you are not seeing what I am seeing, friendship is not by force. How can a woman being like you be threatening you with relationship? If I go out of your life, you are going to suffer. Who told you that? Is he your God? Were you not existing and living before he came? Disassociate from some people. There are some people that make you live a life that is, if you are coming to church very early and somebody is making you to come late and you have warned the person and the person refused, leave that person and start coming to church earlier. That person is not serious and does not value time. And you know where you are going to. You value time. You have to train yourself not the way he or she wants you to live. Somebody shout fire.
Fire.
I did not hear you well.
Fire.
pursue your objectives with diligence, with hard work. That's what it means. Reflecting on the worthiness of your goal will help and keep you on course in life. Number four, be consistent. I'm talking about what is required for a disciplined life. Be consistent. That means that when you say A in the morning, let it be A in the afternoon, let it be A in the night. Don't allow anybody to influence you because of the way they think. There are some people that want to take you away from your life and you want to please them. Some of us, but we are not disciplined. Somebody can even be criticizing your pastor because of what he's saying, you decided to change to support him. Because you don't have a mind of your own. Somebody shout fire. I see a new level of people coming out here. You can't do things anyhow. And from now on, I see you doing things as a disciplined child. You can't be a disciple until you are disciplined. Look at what happened to Gehazi. Because he did not have the self-discipline to refuse money. That's why he lost the anointing. That some of you who are serving under a father, greed for money is killing you. If temptation of money come, you will fall. Anywhere it come, you fall. If you come, hit your head, you fall by head. If you hit your leg, you fall by leg. If you hit your hand, you fall by hand. See, now where man they walk, now man they eat. Those are stupid philosophies. You cannot be eating from corruption. These are things you must work on yourself. Work on yourself. I told you I went to a country and the vice president of the country wanted to see me. And some of the pastors were angry because I turned it down. Hey, why? I said, shut up. They were telling me the importance. I said, are you the one that will tell me the importance or I'll tell you the importance? When they saw that it was not a matter of an opinion, it was a matter of a decision. They saw how I became very adamant and I rebuked them. They kept quiet. They were grumbling behind, that's none of my business. I'm in charge here. What they wanted me to do, I didn't do it. But at the tail end, it happened that a man came. Why? Because I understand that I have to be self-disciplined. That the anointing is not paid for money. There are little pastor, young pastor, one big man, they are running after his house, knocking the door, prophet lying. I see your head. I see cow. I see monkey all over the tree. Because they want to get money. Big men will never honor you when you devaluate before them. That's why when I hear some politicians say, you know, I have all these men of God. I pay them. I get offended when I hear a politician brag before me over that. You can't pay a man of God. It is God that rewards us. You are only a supporter to the work. You can't brag that I'm in charge of the ministry. When you begin to do that, that man of God has sold his birthright. That's why I speak here in this ministry. If you are offended, don't pay your tithe. Don't pay. Withdraw your tithe. When a man of God lives at the mercy of his members, he can't tell them truth. He will be afraid that if he said the truth, they will stop helping him. And that's why the help of a man of God must come from above, not from man. Am I talking to somebody? Somebody shout fire. Shout fire. I'm talking about self-discipline. Spiritual discipline. This discipline that produces rugged manifestation. When I'm talking about spiritual discipline, discipline to pray when you should pray. The Holy Spirit tap you, wake up to pray, and you can't pray. Then you now have a dream, they are pressing you. How will they not press you? Spiritual discipline. When men of God go for pastoral meeting and they exchange blows to one another, are they disciplined? System than the Holy Spirit.